Good evening and welcome to these test transmissions on 160 metres and 2 metres streaming online as well. This is VK3SL. Back to Friday routines, folks. Have had a fabulous break and I'm in the mood to indulge and to play some unusually modulated sounds that you'd hear nowhere else, and there's absolutely no entertainment intended whatsoever. I have to make that perfectly clear. This is very much a technical exercise. All right, to capture the mood of the week, I've dug up something which sort of, I think it's quite topical. So let's have a listen to... No, I'm not going to tell you what it is. See what you think. VK3SL testing.
If you are longing and yearning for something that's different to do, worry no more, for fate has in store such a surprise for you. Pack up a dream and head for Haven Island. Never a care beneath the tropic sun. No need to dream when you're at Haven Island. More than a share of fun for everyone. You'll revel in the beauty of a coral pool, go cruising under clear blue skies, romance among magnolias when the night is cool. What a wonderful Pacific paradise. So pack up a dream and head for Haven Island. Then you will find your dream has all come true. For there's holiday happiness at Haven for you. Among magnolias when the night is cool. What a wonderful Pacific paradise. So pack up a dream and head for Haven Island. Then you will find your dream has all come true. For there's holiday happiness at Haven for you.
Straight from the Islands, that was John O'Connor and the Mob at 3DP. Custom record made for the Haven Island Resort back in the 50s. Well, I wasn't at Haven Island, but I was, well, reasonably close. And it was a great couple of weeks. Nice to be sort of in a different zone. Lots of time to think and reflect and see new things. And that was a most satisfactory holiday, and good to see the kids reveling in a new experience as well. Anyhow, so I've been listening a lot, actually. I've had lots of listening time as well, so I'm sort of priming myself up with new thoughts about these missions as well. But we do have a bit of a time-honoured tradition to maintain. So let's have a listen to Mr. Prosuge, who's put out another test pressing of Arthur Lally's orchestra from 1930. Another superlative transfer, and this recording is Here Comes Emily Brown. I'm VK3SL testing.
Look the way. Here comes Emily, got in today. Here comes Emily, preacher will say, hello, Emily Brown. Clean up the aisle, here comes Emily, put on a smile. Here comes Emily, look at the style, there's no sweeter in town. Now is the time for kisses. How is I doing with my missus? Smothered in rice, here comes Emily, nicer than nice. Here comes Emily, better look twice. Here comes Emily Brown.
That was Morris Selman with Arthur Lally's Orchestra on a test pressing and issued by Mr. Prosut this week, one of his recent uploads, and there's a couple of other tracks there as well worth exploring for future missions. This is VK3SL. We're testing here on 160 metres, 2 metres, and streaming online as well. And everyone, of course, is welcome to get their receivers out and practice their slope detecting techniques and take fastidious notes as they go to make sure that all of their equipment is running to working to plan. And, of course, I'm very judiciously checking things here as well. We have to be correct with our procedures. All right, then, we'll move on and... what next? There's so many things to, so many directions I could go tonight. In fact, I was going to have a big Stockhausen and night tonight. When I was away, I was listening to recordings of Mantra with the shortwave radio with the CW. And there's a wonderful lecture by Mr. Stockhausen, and where he describes the ideals and all of the harmonic relationships using his ring modulator. And it's such a, it's very technically interesting. And of course, it relates quite directly to radio. So that was going to be the whole thing tonight, but then something else has emerged which will sort of take precedence a bit later on, which will signify my change of direction. Anyhow, enough of that. Let's have a listen to, some 20 stuff. Oh, look, I found out a bit about I was trying to find a way to define what I like about mid-1920s dance band. I often struggle to articulate what it is. And one of the things is that suspended animation you get, where you often get a cymbal crash, usually very closely mic'd and splats like anything, and then you get this silence, or you get a sudden textual change. And that's a really, it's really exciting, because music, that's the first time that technique, that heightened syncopated technique came into the fore. So, and there's actually a word for it, believe it or not. It's called the drop. The drop is where you have that... the music's riding along on a particular level and suddenly there's that massive gear change. Well, I can sort of illustrate that a little bit here. Where is it? Here it is. Here's a little bit of an example of a drop, and then we'll sort of explore the notion a little bit as well. So have a listen to this. This is from Abe Lyman. We'll play the whole track in a minute, but listen for the drop. There is a sudden silence, and then they say, shake that thing. Let's have a listen. An incredible tension and release when they with that technique, and it has incredible dramatic impact. Now I'll play that whole track in a minute, but let's have a listen to what I think is the first instance of the drop ever recorded. Now I think this goes back to 1925, a year before the recording we just heard, and it is with Fletcher Henderson's band, with Louis Armstrong featuring in the band as well. He was sort of like a guest member, and he was the hot soloist. And if you have a listen to this, towards the end, they do one of these drop techniques, and it's quite effective. And I think, by all accounts, it's the first time that that technique was used. And, of course, it was exploited to the nth degree. From this point onwards, all that mid-20s dance band music featured the stop cymbal and then that sudden... that shock tactic. So that jarring. But here we go. Here's the first example. Sugarfoot Stomp, Fletcher Henderson and his orchestra with a young Louis Armstrong from 1925, VK3SL.
Thank you.
There we go. That was Sugarfoot Swamp with Fletcher Henderson and the orchestra with a young Louis Armstrong. And there was a couple of instances of the drop. It's fairly sort of subtle in that instance. It hadn't sort of had its found its full dramatic impact. But that actually may in part be due to the fact that the recording, I think it's an acoustic recording from 1925. And it wasn't August that year that they started doing electrical recordings in earnest. Now, we'll go back and have a listen to that original one I played before. That's the this recording from 1926 with Abe Lyman. Now, the whole effect is just heightened so much by the massive distortion you get from the light beam recording process. Is just so much intermod that the band sounds hyper. It sounds so charged, and I really like the effect. I think it just makes music from this period sound more than alive. And you'll hear the instances of the drop, you'll hear the way that these gear changes and these declamatory moments with this stopped cymbal just define the music. So yeah, here we go from 1926, Shake That Thing, Abe Lyman and the orchestra, and we'll listen for the big drop. That euphoric distortion. Well, there we go. It's got to play again. Euphoric distortion with Abe Lyman from 1926. Yes, full of high drama and incredible intensity, white hot intensity. And of course, that's exploiting a whole new movement towards really energized syncopated music and gear changes everywhere, playing with your expectations. That's what's happening, folks. Yeah, look, let's continue. One of the bands that really used those techniques to incredible dramatic effect was the Koonsanders Band, and particularly their recordings from 1925 and 26. Really hot band at that point. The arrangements are always interesting, and they used that drop technique a lot, but they used to fill the drop with the, or they made it into a break. So you'd have a really strong declamatory cymbal, and then there'd be a textural change, a little break. Usually very interesting, actually, in the Koonsanders Band. You hear a saxophone section solo, which is quite involved and texturally interesting. And then it sort of leads you into a different mood or a different layer. So, yeah, let's have a listen to one of their really good examples of this technique. Everything is hotsy totsy now. So yeah, we'll go back to 1926, I think, in this example. This is Koonsanders' original Nighthawks, Nighthawks 3 VK3SL testing. Oh, this is really frustrating. Do you know what's happening? Well, I'm going to go back and start it again, because I have a feeling. I set this up a couple of hours ago, so we had people over, and what's happened is there's a bit of a buffering problem. So that what's happened... Whoa, hold your horses. What's happened is that they've sort of partially buffered up, and then it has to restart or has to break. Now, I'm afraid that's not a part of the dramatic effect. It's just an artifact of being a little bit too organized. So sorry about that. We'll give it another run and see if we can get a continuum this time. VK3SL testing. Yes, using cymbals for high dramatic effect, and I think they must have had them right under the microphone so that they splattered to full effect. So there we go. That was Coon Sanders' original Nighthawks from 1926, and we're looking at the splat effect, the drop effect, the amazing sort of sense of declamatory statements in mid-20s dance band music. It sort of ironed out and became a bit more sophisticated later on, but there's a raw energy in music from that time, which I find incredibly compelling. Another example from the same band, I think, while we're on this track, but I'm just going to waffle on for a minute until it... so we don't get that unfortunate problem with it restarting. That's going to plague me all evening, I think. That's a bit of a nuisance. Never the mind. Well, I think I've found enough leadway into it now. We're going to hear another one from that Charleston craze. Now, Charleston, by definition, lends itself very well. The chord progressions lend itself very well to using that effect. But this has got some really incredible dramatic moments of the kind I've been describing. Let's have a listen. VK3SL testing. About that for a splat at the end, right under the microphone, and everything just went completely all right. So that's our little exploration tonight. I've just sort of been pondering that. I was thinking, what do I really like about mid-20s dance band music? And it is the splat factor. It's that way that those gear changes take your breath away. Those that tension and release with the syncopation and all that offbeat emphasis. It's wonderful. Okay, well, I'll have to review my playlist because I'm not going to put up with having its job stopping and starting all the time. It could be something else. Actually, I've noticed my stream is... Yes, I monitor off the stream and that's stopped too. So maybe it's a problem also with the internet. All right, well, look, I'll have a plan B for a little while, and we'll see if I can sort some of this out. But I have something here of particular interest, and because I do think that we all need lessons from the Godfrey Stanton Hicks School of Eloquent Speaking. And I had a bit of a dig around, and I found my Bryson Taylor record. And this, I haven't played it all. There's a few sections I haven't played. And I think we all need to stand back, have a good listen, and take stock of ourselves, learn about our elocution, learn about our presentation, our pronunciation, and our dotting all of the I's and stroking the T's, and being very politically correct and very, very Englishly determined in our vocabulary. So let's handball over to Mr. Bryson Taylor for a little bit of patronizing eloquence.
Many of us are conscious of having voices which lack strength, depth, and resonance. All voices can be improved by having an adequate breath supply, a trained control of breath emission, and a proper direction or placing of the tone in the resonating cavities. Let us examine these factors more closely. First, an adequate breath supply and proper breath emission. Test yourself this way. Stand or sit erect with your chest up and your lower abdominal muscles held in. Shoulders steady. Now take in an average breath through the nose. Now count aloud in a firm, clear voice up to 20. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. As the breath goes out, you keep the lower abdominal muscles held in. Hold the chest up during the counting, keep the shoulders steady, and don't let the lower abdominal muscles sag or collapse as the breath goes out. You can vary this simple exercise by reciting the alphabet on one breath. Use your lips, tongue, and jaw freely and flexibly as you do it, and you'll give yourself a good articulation exercise as well. This exercise will give you good posture and helps in the steady control of breath emission. If the breath is allowed to rush out as you speak, the tone becomes breathy and has no carrying power. We're all acquainted with the speaker who habitually uses a breathy, over-urgent, jerky manner of speech. And we have the voice which becomes weak and cracking in quality, especially on the last few words of a phrase. There may be psychological causes for these forms of speech, which are often used by people of high intellect. The root cause is much more likely to be incorrect use of the breathing muscles and poor placement of the voice. The breathing muscles are, in the main, the diaphragm, the intercostal or rib muscles, the midriff, and abdominal muscles. If you lift your chest, you will notice how these abdominal muscles come into play. Notice, too, how they eject the breath on sudden natural impulses, such as laughter, a cough, or a sudden shout of, "Hey!" This inward impulse of the midriff or lower abdominal muscles is nature's way of feeding the tone with breath. A slight upward lift of the lower abdominal muscles on an emphatic word or phrase gives the voice more fullness and resonance. Now for proper direction or placing of the tone in the resonating cavities. The main resonating cavities, or amplifiers of vocal tone, are the chest, the larynx, or voice box, the pharynx, or the back of the throat, the mouth with its hard and soft palates, the facial and nasal cavities, and the sinuses or head cavities. All these resonators will vibrate when you direct the tone to them. Perhaps the best way of getting this direction or placement of tone is to close the lips lightly, as on the letter M, and make a humming sound. Do this on a comfortable pitch, about middle C, in this manner. You'll notice a certain amount of vibration will be felt around the nose and in the head. Test this by placing your fingers lightly on your lips while humming. At the same time, place your hand flat on your chest, and again you will feel light vibrations. Although the humming sound is mainly felt in the front of the face or the mask, it is generated in the larynx, and you can test this by touching the larynx lightly and so feel the vibrations of the vocal cords. What is happening is that the fundamental sound being made in the larynx is also being amplified by overtones or harmonics created by sympathetic resonance of the different cavities. This is how our great singers get their brilliant tones. Resonance is never gained by gripping or trapping the tone in the throat. The tone should float out through a free open throat and be directed to the resonators with the breath well in support. Those of you who are interested in public speaking must lift up your voice with strength. Lift it up. Be not afraid. Those of you who just want to improve your everyday speech can do likewise in a milder way by keeping before you the value of good posture, good breath support, proper placing of the tone, and of course, flexible and correct articulation.
Okay, there we have it. That was Mr. Bryson Taylor giving us all a very important lesson on how to articulate ourselves in the appropriate way, in the Godfrey Stanton Hicks exemplary way of speech. We have to slow down, we have to pronounce our words, we need to speak with exactitude. Well, there's no exactitude in this recording. It's simply marvellous, and in its freedom and free spiritness and everything else. We're going to go back to 1933, I think it is. I think it's 33, and I'm scrolling over, looking at the list here. Yes, here we have some vintage Japanese music, and I'm not even going to try and pronounce it, but I'll tell you is it's recorded on a Nitto record in 1933. This is VK3SL testing. Right. there we have it. That was beautiful, very ethereal. And I have to say, I've just noticed that our power's wound back a little bit. I'm hoping that everyone can still hear okay. It's just a product of this thermal issue we were having some weeks back. It's resurfaced, but I'm not going to get waylaid by it. I'm still putting out about 50 watts or so of carrier, but I don't think I can do much at this stage. I might be able to do a retune and try that method to get my SWR under 1:2 ratio, but we'll see what happens. We might look down that track a little bit later on. Anyhow, we'll keep things moving, I think, and we'll have a listen to... Yes, we have some modern jazz quartet fans in the listenership, and so we'll definitely have an item. And this one also features Bobby McFerrin, and it's called Bag's Groove. This is VK3SL testing.
Thank you.
you, that was Bobby McFerrin with a group called Take Six, and they played with the Modern Jazz Quartet, a piece called Bag's Groove. And so that's for our Modern Jazz Quartet fans. And I know Frank loves Bobby McFerrin's music too, so I was pleased to stumble on that one. Now, what I might do is I might just try a little strategy with this. I've had mild success with this thermal problem by switching over to the tuner and retuning, but it does end up being a little bit of a case of chasing my tail. So we'll just give it a bit of a burl. And so I'll set the standby. I'm going to drop off for just a memento. Okay, hopefully I'm in the all right ballpark now. And I won't be delayed anymore by this. Now, that last track we just heard with Bobby McFerrin and the Modern Jazz Quartet, it anticipates the next piece, because we're going to hear the latest offering from Mr. Jacob Collier, a piece called All Night Long. And he just put this out this morning. It just came out, and it's fantastic. He's actually collaborating with a whole range of musicians, and it's just full of texture and interest and dynamics, and it's amazing what this fellow achieves. And so I think it sort of follows on quite nicely from what we just heard. So, yeah, let's hear Jacob Collier, All Night Long. This is the official video, I might add. And, we're not watching it, but we're listening to it. And but I do commend it if anyone wants to have a look at it as well, because it's quite dynamic in presentation. Okay, let's have a listen. VK3SL testing.
And have some fun. Throw away the work to be done. Let the music play on. Everybody sing and everybody dance. Lose yourself in wild romance. We're going to party, glamour, fiesta, forever. Come on and sing. Once you get started, you can sit down.
join the fun. It's a merry-go-round. Everyone's dancing their job away.
Friends, the time has come.
Hold that low.
We're gonna raise the roof and have some fun.
Hold that low.
Life is good, life is sweet. So come on now. Let the music go on and on and on.
Hold that low.
Right, that was Jacob Collier's cover of Lionel Richie's All Night Long. Really dynamic, amazing forces. He has a whole symphony orchestra at his disposal. I'm so pleased he's moved into working with live musicians and expanding his horizons with the whole range of other creative inputs. And I just think he's getting more and more interesting as he develops. We hear him all the time in this household. The Type 3 speakers are used continuously, either playing big romantic symphonies or Jacob Collier. They're the two sort of things that seems to be capture the imagination of one of the inhabitants of this household. In fact, more than one. I'm quite enjoying it too. So yeah, that was Jacob Collier, and we'll keep you posted about any new developments, any of his new pieces I'll play, because I'm quite fascinated by this character. He's got the most amazing sense of pitch, and it's such a creative mind, and he's just self-producing all these incredible things. And what a visionary. Okay, well, Let's have a look. Oh, yes, OTR time. Now, what have I got? You can hear the fans buzzing away furiously there. There's a real fan club in here, but nothing to do with my exploits. They're all trying to coax the transmitter into behaving itself. All right, so OTR, yes, I was digging through a pile of records and found a set of Astor adverts, I suppose they are, and so I thought I'd give them a burl, and so we'll do that first and then see where things lead. So this is VK3SL. We're testing here, of course, nothing to do with entertainment whatsoever. So I say that with utter sincerity. You must make sure that you have your hands tied behind your back and that you are concentrating very with great determination on the technical prowess of these enterprises.
Because people are different, Astor makes a lot of different television sets. The radio announcements you are about to hear are designed to motivate these people to choose an Astor television set to suit their individual taste. We hope you are moved too.
Oh, Kate, you know something about television sets, don't you?
Sets, I know a lot. Thinking ask of me anything you want to know and I'll tell you about television sets. Uh-huh. Now, screens, for instance. Do you want little screen or big screen?
Oh, I think
12-inch, 17, 23, 24. They even come in 25-inch screens now for the wider viewing.
Yeah.
You want square corners, you want rounded corners. You want legs, wheels, you want to make it portable.
You know, you can sweep under.
You want to play records on this set?
These days, there's no such thing as a basic television set.
Maple or even walnut.
And since no two people are really the same, there's no reason they should want to have the same set. That's why Astor makes such a wide range of sets. It simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
You want a portable TV on wheels, then your husband can watch it in the bath.
Oh, Kate, in the bath.
Or in bed.
Oh.
Hey, Ralph, you know something about television sets?
Sure I do. You can have big screens or little screens. It's 12-inch, 17-inch, 23-inch, 24-inch, 25-inch. You want square corners?
Square.
You want rounded corners?
No, rounded.
Now, legs. Do you want legs or do you want wheels? You want to make it portable?
Probably take it in the bedroom.
You want to play records in this set? You want a stereo then? And what about radio? And what about colour? You want teak, maple, walnut?
These days, there's no such thing as a basic television set. And since no two people are really the same, there's no reason they should want to have the same set. That's why Astor makes such a wide range of sets. It simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
Good night, Ralph.
Do you want Queen Anne's legs?
Oh, Kate, you know something about television
sets, don't you? Ask me anything you want to know and I'll tell you about television sets.
Uh-huh.
Now, screens, for instance. Do you want little screen or big screen?
Astor makes a very wide range of television sets, which simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
Do you want teak, maple or even walnut?
Hey, Ralph, you know something about television sets?
Sure I do. You can have big screens or little screens. It's 12-inch, 17-inch, 23-inch, 24-inch, 25-inch.
Astor makes a very wide range of television sets, which simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
What about colour? You want teak, maple?
Ask me anything you want to know and I'll tell you about television sets.
Uh-huh.
Now, screens, for instance. Do you want little screen or big screen?
Oh, I think
12-inch, 17, 23, 24...
Astor makes a very wide range of television sets, which simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
One speaker or two speakers.
You can have big screens or little screens. It's 12-inch, 17-inch, 23-inch, 24-inch, 25-inch. You want square corners?
Square.
You want rounded corners?
No, rounded.
Now, legs. Do you want legs?
Astor makes a very wide range of television sets, which simply means you can get the set you want from Astor.
You want an indoor antenna? You want to take it
out? Well, I hope you're thoroughly fatigued by that bit of redundancy there. That was the Astor record. There's quite a few of them there. And they just feature promotional material from, I suppose, the early 60s, I imagine. Now, there's been quite a bit of interesting sort of dialogue and yeah, interest in the talking clock theme. And it's good to see the high-res Australian talking clock YouTube offerings now in our midst. And of course, we are aware that the talking clock is now no more. I suppose I'll make my paltry little contribution to the talking clock theme. And I believe this is the oldest surviving recording. And except for an early recording on glass, which was never played back, this particular recording I'm going to play goes back to 1878, and it's on one of Edison's tinfoil cylinders, and it's an experimental talking clock. So we'll hear some voices from the middle of after the middle of the 19th century, and see what you think. It's almost indistinguishable, but it is a talking clock. Someone's giving some time signals here, and from 1878. Have a listen, see what you think. VK3SL testing. I think that's all that's vaguely intelligible, and it's sort of an alarm clock, and apparently it's sort of wake up or something they say after that. Here's a bit more now, I think. No, it's not really playable, but I just thought I'd give you a little sample of that, your talking clock from 1878. Now, what we'll have a listen to is a British doco, and this is about give the auditions for the speaking clock in 1935 in Britain. So they auditioned people. They had a panel of laureates and poets and people of influence who listened to get the perfect voice, the perfect eloquent voice for the talking clock in Britain. And you'll hear the outcome. So this is quite charming. So here it's called Golden Voice for Automatic Phone Replies is Chosen. So this is the competition, VK3SL.
Enunciation of poetry is one of the tests imposed on the candidates in the Post Office's Golden Voice competition. And this is not inappropriate, for the Poet Laureate is one of the judges. Mr. Stuart Hibbard, chief announcer of the BBC, is another. Sitting next to him is Dame Sybil Thorndike.
And at my window bid good morrow through the sweet briar or the vine or the twisted eglantine.
Then comes Mr. John Masefield, wrapped in meditation.
Scatters the rear of darkness thin and to the step...
Mrs. Atkinson, selected as the perfect telephone subscriber.
Before, oft listening how the hounds and horns.
And finally, Lord Eilif.
Lumbering morn. And every shepherd tells his tale under the hawthorn in the dale.
What do you think of that voice, Miss Thorndike?
I think it's a charming voice. A beautiful tone and sense of rhythm. I should like to hear her do the time sentences.
Yes, so should I.
At the third stroke, it will be 4:33 and 40 seconds. At the third stroke,
Miss Kane, the winner, is congratulated by Major Tryon, the new Postmaster General.
Let you, Miss Kane. It is your voice that we shall hear when we ring up the speaking clock to know the time.
Thank you. Well, I'm thrilled, absolutely thrilled to have won this competition. So if you want to know the time, there's no need now to ask a policeman. Just give me a ring sometime.
Whoa, it caught me off guard. There you have it. That was the speaking clock, the Archivist Presents, from one of the, I think it's from the British Movie Tone News Archive, I think. Yes. She looked very pleased with herself at the end, at least. And she had a smile on her face. Anyhow, so sad to hear that the talking clock has gone from Australia. It's the end of an era, I suppose. And but there's plenty of interest in the subject, and I had a good look at the... Our videos, Mr. ASC's videos, and they're interesting. Alrighty, so we move on. Oh yeah, we're going to have a sort of a classical segment now, moving into the last the home run. And tonight I'm sort of thinking of, well, I was going to do the Stockhausen thing, but I'm sort of not in the really in the mood. I've listened to quite a bit this week and listened to the lectures, and they are good, and I will feature especially mantra. And if anyone's to have listened to part three of the mantra lecture, it is quite compelling. He's an interesting orator. He's someone who had who was just restless and curious and constantly finding new ways to express himself, and that's something I find compelling in any artist, is that want and curiosity, something that's just like a disease. You've got to be on the front foot, I think, otherwise we all sort of ossify and evaporate, something like that. Anyhow, right, we're going to have a listen to some great artists who've passed away in the last 2 weeks. There's three, and very important musicians or players of influence and who made great statements in their lives. And one of them was is Paul Badura Skoda, pianist, and where is he from? I think he's. Where does it say? I'll find out. I'll find out some biographical details later, because he is one of these international artists, but I'm not quite sure exactly where he was from at the start. Anyhow, he started recording in the mid-50s, and he died this week at the age of 91. And so we'll just hear a small offering of Mr. Badura Skoda, a very fine musician, great Bach interpreter. I've got quite a lot of his Bach records here, and I have quite a few of his chamber music offerings, so we might sort of dig one of those up for a future missions. But we'll have a listen to one of his early recordings. This is from 1956. It's the Bach's Invention No. 1 in C major, BWV 772. So we're listening to the music of Paul Badura Skoda, VK3SL testing. Was indeed from Austria. That was Paul Badura Skoda in 1956 with Bach's Invention No. 1 in C major. Beautiful playing. It's got lots of space, and I love music that sort of has that meandering quality to it. Not too urgent, and Bach's music lends itself well to that sort of, particularly that the inventions. We'll hear now a recording of Mr. Badura Skoda, recorded just shortly before he died in his 90s. And I think this is a really great testimony to how the musical spirit lives on, and people if you enjoy music and you can be invigorated by music, you don't have to be a player, but music is something that's good, I think, for anyone's disposition, keeps people young. Certainly kept Mr. Badura Skoda young. He's playing superbly here. A movement from a Mozart sonata, I think it is. And this was put up in his memory. It's a concert he gave only a few months ago. So very recent. And so this is from Mozart's Piano Sonata in C minor, KV 457. We'll just hear the slow movement. And again, Mr. Paul Badura Skoda at the very end of his life, a bookend performance.
Thank you.
So Vale, Paul Baduriscota, that was his last recital recorded on May the 31st this year. And he's in his 91st year. And I love hearing older musicians play because there's the wisdom of a whole life of music making. And people, once they get past a certain point, don't worry about being perfectionistic anymore. And their musical ideas somehow shine through because they're not trying to be perfect and play safe. So there's something quite compelling about that, I think. This is a special performance. I sat up and watched the whole thing this morning, and he's like a skeleton at the piano, and it's amazing, and he's doing so well. He plays the entire program by memory. It includes a Schubert's impromptus, what else, Schumann's Kinderschen, and also this Mozart sonata, the KV-457. But remarkable. And I've known of his recordings for some time, and especially his chamber music collaborations, so I will have to find them. Some of them, I think, are on Westminster and some of the less well-known LPs, or less mainstream, I suppose. But yes, he was indeed an Austrian pianist of note. Okay, so what do we have next? Oh, yes. Look, we'll play a little bit more Mozart. And it's the Horn Concerto KV-495. It's his fourth horn concerto. So let's have a listen. I'll just have to switch this turntable in, and we go straight off the disc. VK3SL testing. Thank you. Yeah, that was the Mozart's the Rondo from Mozart's Horn Concerto in E-flat major, KV-495. We heard Kurt Black and the Bamberg Orchestra. That was the RIAS Symphony Orchestra, actually, conducted by Leopold Ludwig. And that was on a Deutsche Grammophon Gesellschaft. Is that what they say? Gesellschaft. Yes. Okay. So one of those 50s Deutsche Grammophons. Beautiful product, the way they're presented with their flap covers and their heavy vinyl, and they're very well promoted and presented. All right, so we move on, and now I'm just honouring a request from Mr. Fleming. Mr. Fleming emailed me while we were away, and he's sent a link to this next recording, which I really enjoyed, and I'm very keen to hear the music of Bach played with unusual ensemble combinations. I think Bach's music works in all manner of ways, and you don't have to play it the conventional way. It's great to hear sort of excursions into different realms, different possibilities. Now, we're going to hear the recorder player, Genevieve Lacey, and the accordion player, James Crabb. And so this is an example of a reappropriation of Bach's Sonata number 3 in D minor. We're just going to hear the Andante movement, and we'll hear these guys play it. Very beautiful performance. I love hearing the recorder. I'm back in stereo, by the way, if anyone's wanting to listen in stereo. So this might come up quite well. But see what you think of this combination. It's not at all orthodox, but I think very effective. Music of Bach, played by Genevieve Lacey on the recorder and James Crabb on the accordion. Really effective. I love it. It's amazing how the Bach's music just is always alive, no matter what combinations. And look, they played that so well. It was full of you know, character and subtlety. And I thought that was really interesting. Okay, well, we move into sort of a dark corner now. I don't mean for this to be depressing. Just something more introspective. So it's sort of a melancholy without being sort of overdramatic or depressing. But, I'm going to just play a track from a Polish composer called Prishna. And this is the music from a film which came out in 1989 or 90, thereabouts. And a film called The Double Life of Veronique. And it's about a girl who, a Polish girl who has a double. And they're both exactly the same person, but living separate lives. And they're only sort of vaguely aware of each other. And they live in, it's a great portrait of Polish life at that time. It's a film that really captured both my imagination and Kate's imagination. We talked about it a lot and we watched it quite a few times, and it's a film I really like. The music is really haunting right through, and when one of the doubles dies, the other person feels very acutely the passing of her double, and it's quite powerful the way that I'm giving the game away now, but this music sort of accompanies it. In fact, one of them's a singer and she drops dead while she's singing the song. So, yes, it is pretty heavy in one sense, but trying to sort of not contextualize it like that. I think it's music that just has a beautiful standalone quality, and it sort of leads into the final section quite well, I think. So see what you think. And it's very, very haunting and beautiful, and it's by the composer Prishna, and who's still up and running and writing lots of interesting music. I had to read about him the other day, but see what you think. VK3SL testing.
Thank you.
We heard the music of Zbigniew Prestner. That was the Vanda Budenmeier Concerto. It's sort of a pseudo-baroque piece, which is the music which is omnipresent in the film, The Double Life of Veronique, the Kieslowski film, Double Life of Veronique. And a marvellous film, and a very powerful piece that sort of galvanises the movie, I suppose. But, yeah, it permeates every scene, virtually, in one way or another. That theme, that expansive theme. I wanted that to lead into just a reflection on the very sad news that Jessie Norman passed away this week, and she was only in her mid-70s and sort of a bit premature, and she's one of the great singers, really great singers of the century, and a voice to die for, beautiful voice. And so I wanted to sort of play a couple of pieces in her memory. So one of them is one of the Mahler Rocket Lieder. This is number 3 of that song cycle. It's the Ich bin der Welt abhanden genug gekommen, which I think translates to, O garish world, long since thou hast lost me. And we'll hear this performed by Jessie Norman some years ago, and but just gives an idea of what a remarkable voice she had. So, yeah, this is lamenting the sad loss of Jessie Norman. This is VK3SL testing. Thank you. Well, singing like that really does leave me speechless, and I don't think there's any way to describe such exquisite beauty. It was wonderful. Music of Jesse Norman singing Marla, recorded in 1971. Erwin Gage was the pianist on that record. We'll hear a bit more of Jesse Norman at the very end. But another great composer has passed away this week, and this is Gaia Cancelli. He's a Georgian composer, very influential figure and very well represented. He wrote a lot of film music as well. So let's have a listen to this, and it goes for about 10 minutes. It's very different to what we've just heard. It starts with a big bang and then just moves into another very ethereal well, I'd say minimalist, maximalist textures, like looking at a painting with very thick textures, thick brush strokes. It's one way of describing it, I suppose, but you'll find your own way of interpreting this music, I'm sure. This is VK3SL testing. We just heard Mourned by the Wind as the first movement. Largo by Gaia Cancelli, who passed away this week. In fact, he passed away 2 days ago at the age of 84. It's very expansive, soulful music. And long, subdued, anguished lines. Broad orchestral textures. It's very... I find it very ethereal, and I'm sure Mr. Kavaracek would thoroughly approve. He would have explored the music of Cancelli, I'm sure, in his programs different times. Okay, well, we're at the point, folks, where we're going to wind things. One more offering just to wrap it all, and again, as per usual, I won't back announce it, but I will come back and listen on Channel D afterwards. So I thank you for listening this far, if you've done so. And, yeah, it's nice to have the known company of some people. So have a good week, and we'll be back again, no doubt, next week. We're going to finish with the music of Jessie Norman again. And this time we'll hear her singing Purcell's When I Am Laid in laid in earth. So that's a fitting way to close, I think, and we'll let this conclude. This is VK3SL bidding everyone a very good week. Thank you.